Now that was a hard act to follow. So we turn tonight in the text of God's Word to 1 Samuel chapter 5. Okay, let's pause for a moment of heart preparation for the Word of God and for a brief prayer. Our Father, as we come once again to the text of Your Word, we ask that Your Holy Spirit illuminate our hearts to the meanings that You have placed into history, teachings that You have included in the canon of Scripture, a scriptural canon that has been protected over many centuries against many adversaries. And we thank You that we tonight have the freedom here, while brethren elsewhere do not have this freedom, that we do have freedom to come together, to assemble, and to look to You, our Savior and our God. In Christ's name, amen. In working through the framework last evening, we mentioned that you got what?
You gotta fix your mic so that it hangs here. So it fits every year a little differently.
Okay. Last night we covered an analysis of the culture, and we looked at the weaknesses of unbelief. And I think since we're in a spiritual warfare, that warfare is against a very brilliant opponent. But because it is rebellion against God and against His design, it's fundamentally out of kilter. And it's encouraging to realize that the enemy does have vulnerabilities. And we spelled some of those vulnerabilities out last night. We pointed out the danger of teaching fragments of truth unprotected by a network of corresponding truths. That amoeba illustration that I used, that amoeba just swallows it up. This morning you heard John Cross pointing out how in Asia and how in the Eastern cultures, if you preach what we think is very clear message, but it's done in a very partial way, not connected to a framework from creation to culmination, they will quickly absorb the message and neutralize it. That's the reality that we face. But we've also noted last time that unbelief is unstable. There's a metastability about it, that it's like a seesaw that rocks back and forth. And it rocks necessarily between two poles, the so-called problem of the one and the many. And this has been known for centuries. This is not new. This has been well explored far before actually the time of Christ. The pre-Socratics, Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle did a lot of work in exposing these kinds of issues. And the issues are that if you look only to sensory experience, all the multitude and details of life, and that's all you have, you wind up with fragments, pieces, chaos, things change. We showed the diagram that if you can concentrate on N pieces of data, and that's all you have, what do you do when you discover the N plus one piece of data? Your knowledge is always contingent, waiting on the next fact to come into the picture. So if you go and deal with sensory experience, you wind up ultimately in despair and skepticism. You have no stability to your knowledge. On the other hand, if you also choose not to follow the Word of God, and you elect to go the other side of the seesaw and emphasize abstract reason and concepts to get stability and knowledge, now the problem is you're dealing with abstractions that are no longer related to the flux of time. And so this is the seesaw that we said goes back and forth. And it's a perpetual weakness. Isaiah said it well when he said, the wicked are like the troubled sea that can find no rest, going from one side to the other. We know that all unbelief, in spite of all the arrogance, in spite of all the intelligence and the brilliance with which it is propounded, and the many permutations and variations, it always has that weakness. Then we said the fulcrum of that seesaw, the pivot of the seesaw, is man trying to uphold a balance, like Atlas trying to hold up the world. And the problem is that inside, we ultimately are creatures made in God's image. We are conscious of Him. We have a conscience that tells us about His righteous judgments. And because we are fallen creatures, we know we have guilt before Him. And we traced that out last night and pointed out that guilt controls the intellect. Adam and Eve, very simple picture. A child can understand this. Very simple picture. That within minutes or hours after Adam and Eve fell, what did they try to do? Hide from God. And the act of merely trying to hide from God tells you that they have changed their theology. What they have done is say to God's omniscience that we're going to not trim that. If it's possible to hide, He can't be omniscient. If it's possible to find some place in the garden where He isn't, He's no longer omnipresent. So immediately we see a re-engineered theology. And if we're honest to ourselves, we know our sin nature, our flesh, does this. It does this very fast. And this is why we constantly have to come back to the Word of God. Only the Word of God can correct this tendency we have as fallen creatures to depart from Scripture, to distort it. The Bible has a word for it, calls it vanity as the result. Also, the other word is idolatry. Well, what we want to do tonight is we want to move into how God counteracts this. Unbelief has to be seen in a wide-ranging thing. It doesn't come to you and to me in little pieces, like sometimes we preach the gospel in little pieces. Unbelief comes through the media. It comes through our relationships. It comes through our institutions. We are surrounded with it. It comes as a whole network of adverse and perverse beliefs. So in this passage tonight in 1 Samuel, there's an easy-to-see story. One of the reasons why I love the Old Testament is because the stories in it are so vivid. And the story that we've chosen tonight to introduce the topic is one that involves the Ark of the Covenant. The Philistines, verse 1, if you follow with me, it's only 9 verses, but this is the story. The Philistines took the Ark of God and brought it from Ebenezer to Ashdod. And when the Philistines took the Ark of God, they brought it into the house of Dagon and set it by Dagon. Dagon was the fish god of the Philistines. And when the people of Ashdod arose early in the morning, there was Dagon, fallen on his face to the earth before the Ark of the Lord. So they took Dagon and set it in his place again. And when they arose early the next morning, there was Dagon, fallen on his face to the ground before the Ark of the Lord. The head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands are broken off on the threshold. Only Dagon's torso was left of it. Therefore, neither the priest of Dagon nor any who came into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon and Ashdod to this day. But the hand of the Lord was heavy on the people of Ashdod. He ravished them and struck them with tumors, both Ashdod and its territory. And when the men of Ashdod saw how it was, they said, "The ark of the God of Israel must not remain with us, for his hand is harsh toward us, and Dagon our God." Therefore they sent and gathered themselves, all the lords of the Philistines, and said, "What shall we do with the ark of the God of Israel?" Now, the story here is a story against syncretism. What God is saying is that I am Jehovah, that is my name, my glory I will not give to another. See, what the Philistines had done is they had brought the ark in and added it to their pantheon. And we have to be careful of this. When we preach Jesus Christ, we mustn't get into the position where we have all the little deities like John Cross showed us this morning, and we're going to add Jesus to the pantheon. The gospel is not an add-on. The gospel is a total replacement. I often use the illustration of imagining yourself thinking about redoing your house, and you're going to have an interior decorator come. And so the day is planned, and you have all your ideas of we're going to change the wallpaper, and we're going to change the scheme of color in the house, and so on. And the morning comes, and you're surprised when you look out the front window, and you see a bulldozer coming toward your house. And what the interior decorator is going to do, he's going to tear your whole house down and rebuild it. Now those two images, the idea of a mere interior decoration or a total reconstruction, that's the difference between syncretism and the gospel. The gospel is a big, big message, and it replaces the whole house. It replaces all the components. And if we don't preach that kind of a big gospel, what we've subtly communicated to our hearers is that our God is just an add-on. It's one of the other gods out there, and we can add him in for the comfort he may give, but let's not disturb the house. The God of the Bible is very disruptive. He enters our lives, and he takes them on paths we might not like. But we have to be open to that. That's the kind of God the Bible presents. So in here, the story in Ashdod is an example. It's an easy to remember story. God does not want to be added on to an existing belief system. He replaces the unbelieving system. So what I want to do tonight is we're going to go to three historic events. And we're going to trace how in each of these three historic events, God expanded special revelation. Now, a word about the two words, special and general revelation. Let me develop those two. They're not well understood today, and I'll give you an illustration from church history. Special revelation is a term that theologians use to refer to things like the Bible. God has spoken into history. It's not mute, it's verbal. It's something that since creation, he has spoken into history. That's special revelation. General revelation is a term that theologians apply to everything he's made. Everything he has made is revealing his hand. The heavens declare the glory of God. Those aren't empty words. When my son was in the Air Force at Okinawa, one of his favorite times was he used to have his quiet times underwater with a snorkel in the waters off the base at Kadena. Why did he do that? Because of the tremendous variety of color under the water. So I can get down there, I see these fish, and it's just clear water, and you see these. Why did God put yellow, orange, purple, green? Why did he do this? There's an effulgence of his glory. He's an artist. Why did he paint all these things? Could have made them all gray, but he didn't. He made them all kinds of color, all kinds of shapes. Why is that? Because that tells us something about our God. He is a God who is omnipotent. He's also a God who is artful. So those are aspects of general revelation. We said Proverbs 25:1, he plays a game of hide and seek with the human race. He says, I've hidden these treasures. Go, sons and daughters of Adam. Go hide and find them out. Dig them out for me. And when we do, and we're looking to him, we glorify him. Now, what has happened in church history is a strange thing. The very people who elevated special revelation at the time of the Reformation, Calvin, Luther, and that group of people, they were eloquent in their authority, their confession of sola scriptura. But an utter failing, and every generation has its own weaknesses. And we can't blame them too much. I mean, they did great in soteriology. If they had just confined their efforts at creedalism to that, we would be better off today. But they froze everything up, and like the Holy Spirit hasn't taught anybody since 1600. The problem, however, is that they made a fatal omission. They fail to say that special revelation is the authoritative interpretation of all general revelation. For example, in the garden, God presumed that Adam knew enough about general revelation to understand trees. So when he said, "Don't eat of that tree," both Adam and his wife conceivably knew what trees were. So there was embedded a general revelation. However, no matter how many experiments they would do, it would be very difficult for Adam and Eve, out of the hundreds of trees in the garden, it would be very difficult for them to figure there was one tree out there that would have given them eternal life, and there was another tree out there that would have given them eternal death. Now, the interpretation of those trees had to come from something other than general revelation. It had to come from special revelation. So we learn something here. Let's not fragment special and general revelation. They fit together. And it's the church's failure to articulate that that has let loose the following scenario. If we do not say that special revelation is the authoritative interpretation of general revelation, then we allow general revelation to be interpreted falsely. And the Universal History Project that we spoke of last night is a result of that process. We have allowed scientists, and Calvin himself allowed this to happen, and he's saying, on the doctrine of common grace, I allow these people to make these interpretations. Wrong. You can go out in general revelation and make hypotheses and so on, but there are constraints built into special revelation about how you interpret general revelation. And of course, one of these battles hit the zenith in the 20th century when the creation evolution controversy came in. Why did that happen? Let's think about that one for a while. Why was there this rupture that happened in 1960 when Henry Morris wrote the book, The Genesis Flood? Why did that happen? It happened because for 200 and 300 years, the geologists were allowed to interpret sedimentary strata in such a way that it undermined the text of Scripture. And it got worse and worse until it got embedded in this big edifice, this big structure, this network, if you will, of unbelief that had frankly captured the only available interpretation of rocks and time and history. Then we suddenly wake up with higher criticism attacking the Bible and wonder, gee, I wonder what happened. It's because we allowed the general revelation to be interpreted over and over and over again, a big edifice of complicated interpretation, because it was never challenged. It was never brought under the authority of special revelation. Nobody ever consulted, never even thought about the fact that the history we are given in Genesis is real history and has to be taken seriously. So general and special revelation must be tied together. Now, God, in His providence, works this out. So we want to cite three examples from history where God providentially worked events within general revelation. He worked out a series of events, set up a situation, and then He invaded that situation with special revelation. Now, He did this many times, but I've selected three. I selected the Exodus, the period of the exile, and the period of early Christian missions into pagan Europe. In each one of these cases, believers were faced with a network of unbelief. Let's take the first one. First one would be Israel in Egypt, Egyptian culture. We can argue about when this happened. It's very disappointing to think that we've had 100 to 200 years of archaeology and research, and we have the constant and stubborn adherence to the standard chronology of the ancient Near East. When it's so flimsy, it's built on Sothic calendar reasoning that no one to this day knows that it's for sure. It's built on speculations about the Egyptian calendar, and it's built on a few eclipses that were poorly observed, and they still don't know exactly where those eclipses were fixed in latitude and longitude. So on the firm foundation of three sloppy areas, we have erected the standard chronology that everyone buys into and then wonders, you know, the whole idea of the Exodus story doesn't really fit in the standard chronology of Egypt. But there again we have the same principle. We allowed for decades upon decades upon decades for all the archaeological material in the ancient East to be organized independently of the scriptures. And then after that house was built up, then we bring it over and say, gee, I wonder how the Bible fits with that. What we should have been doing was asserting the authority of special revelation and saying, look, there are key events. There was a famine in the days of Joseph. Lock into the Egyptian history where the famine was. That's an anchor point. Where there was a destruction of Egypt that was so bad that you don't read about, take a concordance and you can't see one reference to contemporary Egypt from the time of the Exodus all the way to the time of Solomon. Now, why is there an absence of the mention of Egypt? Obviously, Egypt went into an eclipse, or the Hebrews never had any contact with them, and that's hard to imagine. It's a short 11-day trip between the two countries, and for centuries they didn't have contact with each other. Something's wrong here. So here is another example of this business of not subduing general revelation with special revelation. Well, let's look, even though we don't know exactly when the Exodus occurred, we know a little bit about Egyptian culture. So let's look and see what was going on. This morning, John Cross mentioned how he has found in testing evangelism to polytheistic cultures, he has had to, from years of testing now, he's coming to the fact that he's got to go back to the Exodus because it was a total conflict. And we'll see how it was total. In the Egyptian culture, we have paganism illustrated most brilliantly. Egypt is one of the finest examples of high paganism. It was a Gentile millennium almost, and it offered great security. On page 17 of the notes here, I mentioned this from Dr. Henry Frankfurt, who for years taught in the University of Chicago. He says, that in the paragraph, he says, the Egyptian belief was that the universe is changeless and that all apparent opposites must therefore hold each other in equilibrium. Such a belief has definite consequences in the field of moral philosophy. Remember what I said? Follow the implications. Don't just buy into an idea. See where that idea takes you. Sometimes you're surprised. Such a belief has definite consequences in the field of moral philosophy. It puts a premium on whatever exists with a semblance of permanence. It excludes the ideals of progress. It excludes utopias of any kind. It excludes revolutions and any other radical changes in existing conditions. In this way, the belief in a static universe enhances the significance of established authority. Now, that describes the complex of beliefs that affected the entire society. This was top down throughout the whole society. This was Moses' background. This is what he was trained in. This is what the people were brought up to believe, that he was trying to lead out, that he had in the wilderness wanderings, and they wanted to go back to Egypt. In spite of the fact that they didn't like the working conditions in Egypt, Egypt offered a seducing security. There was something secure about the Nile River overflowing and being the source of crops. There was something permanent and encouraging about seeing the pyramids. They don't move too much. So there's a stability built in. And here I'm going to take you through four arts things from Dr. Frankfurt's book. And we'll look at some of the network and the art here. The first one, the first slide, shows a design in an ivory comb in the first dynasty, which shows you how early on these ideas had taken root in Egypt. The god Horus, his symbol was the falcon, is represented on this comb in three ways. At the top, he is the sun in the boat sailing across the sky, right here. In the middle, he is the outstretched wings that depict the sky. At the bottom, he is represented by Pharaoh as he stands on a box containing a serpent and the name of King Jet. The two vertical symbols, left and right, the two vertical symbols are scepters denoting welfare. The sign to the right of the box refers to life. Remember in the 70s, the hippies always wore this around their neck? The interpretation of the art on this comb is that the nature of the god Horus, manifested in the sun and in the sky, is also manifested in the person of Pharaoh. Because Horus is in Pharaoh, life and welfare come from Pharaoh. Now just think about what this comb is looking at. It's looking at the cosmos, the sun, it's looking at the sky, and it's looking at a totalitarian structure of government. Now you can't get much more comprehensive than that statement. And who dominates it but the god Horus? It's his essence that appears in each of those three things. The second artifact shows a temple column also from early Egypt. Again, there are two vertical welfare scepters, but in this example, they are capped above by the sky symbol and below by the earth symbol. Between them is written the name of King Sahura. The implication is, this is interesting, the implication is that the Pharaoh acts within the harmony of nature and was himself a vital part of it, a mediator between heaven and earth. Now, you can't ask for a more secure position for a politician to be in. This is embedded in the very structure of Egypt. Oh, I forgot about the arrows. Okay. The third and the fourth items. The third artifact shows how closely the sun and the serpent appear in Egyptian art. Apparently, to the Egyptian mind, the sun and the snake shared certain characteristics. Both moved without normal means of propulsion. The sun illuminated the physical world, and if pieces of the Noahic Bible were remembered, Genesis 3, the snake, quote, illuminated, end quote, the spiritual world, giving knowledge of good and evil. The fourth artifact proclaimed the deity of Pharaoh. There's Pharaoh, there are two gods. The Egyptian artist draws Ramesses II in the same size as the gods Horus on the left and Hum on the right, with whom he keeps company rather than with mortal men. This type of picture prompted Frankfurt to write, Pharaoh was the fountainhead of all authority, all power, all wealth. The famous saying of Louis XIV that I am the state was levity and presumption when it was uttered, but it could have been offered by Pharaoh as a statement of the fact in which his subjects concurred. It would have summed up adequately Egyptian political philosophy. The structure of Egyptian society was idolatrous from top to bottom. This is what Romans is talking about when it says, when they knew God, they were not thankful. They changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and to beasts and creeping things. Here's the artistic dominion power of man changed and becoming a vehicle for a reconstruction of the universe, in such a way that we separate it from the biblical God. We make it safer for sinners. So we have then the Exodus disruption. And it's interesting that when God starts bringing the Exodus event about, he confronts Moses. And Moses comes in Exodus 3 and he meets God face to face. And the first impression he has is of God's holiness. Take off your shoes, for this is holy ground. So for the first time, perhaps, since the Garden of Eden, man had come face to face physically with the God of the Bible, the Creator. Fire, holiness. The whole nation then, at the foot of Sinai, went through the same thing that Isaiah went through. They saw it, and they said, hey, we need mediator. We cannot take this physical presence of a holy, righteous God. It's that physical presence that stimulates an awareness. Remember Socrates last night? What was his theme? Know thyself. but the heart is desperately wicked. We know ourselves when he tells us who we really are. And when men come face to face with him, then there's this shock, this aversion. John, in the book of Revelation, faints when he sees the physical glory of God. John, Isaiah, and Moses knew themselves after they first knew God. Now, the interesting thing is that when God set up the stories in the Exodus cycle, when he started these acts, who does he come into conflict with? Think about what we've just seen in this artwork. And think about now the Exodus story. God doesn't have Moses doing a sneak rescue mission to take the Hebrews out of Egypt. What does he ask Moses to confront? Who? Pharaoh. And he furthermore says in the book of Exodus, I will make you a god. In other words, Pharaoh claims to be a false god, but Moses, I'm going to make you as God and Aaron as your prophet. And I want you to go in and I want you to confront him face to face, the very center of the network of unbelief. All of the cultural belief values and system was tied up with Pharaoh. And who does God ask Moses to confront? The heart of the unbelieving network. Go for the juggler. This is going to be a total conflict from top to bottom. This is not a piecemeal war. This is a collision of two entire systems of life. And so, just like the Ashdod thing, God does not brook competitors. He is not going to be added onto. He's not going to be assimilated by. He is going to confront. And so we have this confrontation that happens. And after it's all over, and Moses gets toward the end of his life, what body of special revelation does he have in his hand? And does he leave to the rest of us? First five books of the Scriptures. Have you ever thought, why did God choose Moses to compile the Torah, the Pentateuch? I suggest to you it's because the Hebrews coming out of this needed a total answer. They needed special revelation over a whole gamut of lifestyle. They had to know creation to replace the mess of these gods. They had to know about the fall to replace the arrogance of Egyptian culture. They had to know their own history and that what had happened in the Exodus was not some chance event. It wasn't some political maneuver. It wasn't just something that happened. It was related to a contract that had been earlier made with Abraham that was now being systematically working out. Ooh, systematically working out in the chaos of history must mean that behind the apparent chaos of history, there's an order. History really is going somewhere. So all of that has to be explained, and the first five books explain this. So the lesson we walk away with from this first great event is that when God confronted unbelief as a total system, he gave believers a total counter system. The law tells them how to eat. It tells them what to eat. It tells them how to wear their clothes. They had all these conventions in Egypt, and God systematically replaced them. That's the Torah. That's why there are five books. Now let's come to the next event. The next event is the exile. For eight centuries, we're on page 20 of the notes. We come eight centuries now after the Exodus to the exile. And Alva McLean, who wrote one of the finest books on dispensational theology called The Greatness of the Kingdom, says this: the well-being of men, not only physically but every other way, is morally and spiritually conditioned by a principle confirmed by divinely imposed sanctions. Now, this principle holds good generally in all nations in every age, but its operation has often been obscured to human eyes by the time lag between moral breach and infliction of sanction. Furthermore, in the general history of nations, the divine penalties are inflicted through secondary causes behind the veil of providential control. For these reasons, the skeptical have been able to question the existence of any divinely ordained moral government in the human history. But in the case of the nation Israel, over these 8 centuries between Exodus and exile, in the case of the nation Israel, in her mediatorial kingdom of history, the moral government of Jehovah was not only declared at Sinai, but it was confirmed spectacularly in the recorded history of that kingdom by means of general divine sanctions immediately imposed. And these sanctions were generally supernatural. Now we come to this fall. Now this is a classic instance, again, where we treat... Let me go to this slide. This is a classic instance, and by the way, let me go backward there just a minute. These are events in the framework as I teach it. Nothing new here. Basically, I've just taken the major events and said to myself, what do each of these major events teach us? What are they natural pictures of? Creation, the picture of God, man, and nature. It clarifies that. The fall clarifies the whole issue of evil and suffering. The flood is a picture of judgment, salvation. The covenant that God made with Noah, the archetype, first detailed covenant in the Bible, deals with God and his relationships with man and nature. We have the call of Abraham, how he chooses Abraham out, justification, faith, Exodus, and Mount Sinai. So these are the events. And they form a cluster of beliefs, not just one belief, not just one doctrine, not just a fragment, but a system of coherence. Now we come to the exile, and a most strange thing. And I have yet to read, but 2 men, and it maybe more men have commented on this, but I've only found 2 scholars that have ever noticed the point. You would think, just intuitively, if you read the Bible, and you discover that God's Shekinah glory left the nation Israel, that was an important event. And if you read secular historians, the whole exile is treated as sort of a minor footnote, you know, the little Jewish nation got wiped out by the big boys. And that's the way it goes down in history, like it's some sort of minor thing. But what's interesting is that if you look at details of the text, and what did I say? Follow the implications. On page 21 of the notes, I mentioned that the Shekinah glory left. We know that. Second paragraph there is during the years of Israel's decline, we have the convergence of Egypt and Babylon. We have the battle of Carchemish where the Egyptians were defeated. By 603, Nebuchadnezzar had become the undisputed lord and master of the ancient world. At that historical moment, King Nebuchadnezzar had his famous dream. And through his Jewish official Daniel, God revealed a panorama of history from that day until the final reestablishment of the kingdom of God in all its global completeness. Now, if we're astute students of the Word of God, when something like that happens to a prominent king in public, this is not some private thing done in a closet. This is a superpower guy. And this thing is happening to him. Gee, what happened here? This thing is happening to him. Oops. And as it's happening to him, Daniel right there is giving him an interpretation of a vision that spans history. We ought to say, why? Why did God do that then? Why is that the first time that we have a detailed thing like that happening through a Gentile king with a Hebrew prophet interpreting? That's kind of strange, isn't it? Because before it was the Hebrew prophets, but it was Jewish kings. Now we've got revelation somehow coming toward a Gentile king. Still, the Jews are the mediator here. So what does it say in Daniel 2? You, O king, are a king of kings. For the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, a power, and a strength, and a glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the field, or the birds of heaven, he has given them into your hand, and he has made you ruler over them all. And as McLean points out, this could not have happened when Israel was obedient under the terms of the Mosaic Covenant, because they were given the right to not be the tail of a nation. So this is the fall of the kingdom, and this thing happened, and there was a sovereignty of some sort transferred to the Gentiles. And now we have the situation where you have these 4 Gentile kingdoms. And on page 22, that's what I mean when I say transferred unrestrained supremacy to 4 successive Gentile kingdoms. And all of these kingdoms deify the state. You have Nebuchadnezzar deifies himself by perverting Daniel's interpretation of his dream. What does he do after Daniel gets through interpreting his dream? He makes statues of himself, puts them all over the place. Saddam Hussein was not the first guy there that did that kind of thing. Media Persians invented human legislation to the status elevated to divine immutable decrees. The Greeks, in spite of their democratic innovations, furthered the development of the guy that's the type of the Antichrist. And the Romans had emperor worship. So all this was going on and hardening up the Gentile culture. Now, a strange thing happens. The Jews disperse, and what do the Jews take with them in every nation? The Torah, the prophets. The Jews go out into the nations carrying the word of God. As they do this, a strange phenomena happens. These seven things, look at the dates. These are seven major movements in human history that all occurred at the time of the exile. Now, isn't that strange timing? Why do you suppose that six world religions just happened to start at the time of the exile? And why are all these six religions basically share one thing in common? They are overthrowing the ancient priesthoods with all the liturgy and the practice, and they become highly ethical religions. It's how-to religions. Not interested at all in a God who is present in history. It seems to me that there's a strange mirroring here throughout the entire globe at the time of the exile that mirrors what was going on in Israel. The Shekinah glory had left. The personal, direct relationship with God and the priests and the temple were all gone. The Jews moved into their synagogues, and world religions had all these reform movements. We can't be dogmatic here. I just cite this as an example of curiosity. I'm curious as I read the Word of God, why in 586, and then you come over in a religions course and you get all this thing and nobody mentions the fact, why didn't some of these religions happen in 500 and 800 and 700? Why they all happen at the same time? Something's going on in human history. And this is the rise. The last one down at the bottom of this list is Thales. And Gordon Clark and his astute way of his philosophy book. He has a strange sense of humor. He points out, he says in his book, he says, philosophy began on May 22nd in 585. And you say, what? Well, it was that day that we had a solar eclipse. And it's interesting that Thales predicted it. Now, that is a new thing. Where man understands the ways of the gods. And man is now subduing his environment. And man is systematizing measurements and observations. Before, it was the astrologers that would guess at this phenomena. This is new. And this is the rise of the movement toward pre-Socratic philosophy. Again, when? At the time of the exile. At the same time, very interesting, of course, it couldn't be any connection between the diaspora Jewish people taking the scriptures out with the idea in mind that history has a purpose, history is under law, there's a regularity in history because there's a God of order over history. That idea couldn't possibly have any influence with those six world religions. Now, again, let's ask the same question. After the Exodus, what did God do? What did he give believers? He gave them the Torah. He gave them scripture, special revelation that would interpret all of the general revelation in a total system, a total picture. What do we now have in the Old Testament canon by the time the exile happens? We have all the history analysis, do we not? We have Samuel. We have Kings. We have Chronicles. And if you think about it, those men who wrote those books were the first historians. The Greeks were not the first historians, as I was taught in school. It was the Jews that were the first historians. And why do you suppose they wrote books like Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings, Chronicles? What stimulated them to write history? Because they knew there was a contract that God had made. Why do we make contracts? Why do you have a contract with your mortgage company? It's to monitor behavior, isn't it? To clarify terms between parties and to monitor whether the parties are faithful to the contract? Isn't it striking that the Jewish people are the only ones who had contracts with their God? I wonder why that is. That just happens? No, that's because it's a God who controls history, who talks. and he makes a deal. And he has a contract that goes on between him and this nation. And as a contract, it has terms in it. And what do you do with a contract? You monitor behavior by what? Conformity with the terms. So, what was the motive behind the first histories? To see if God was faithful. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was a non-Christian, I could care less about history. The only thing I liked about history was it was easy to memorize the dates, so I could pass the test and go forget it for the next test. History was just a pile of marbles. And that's the way it has to be taught on a secular basis. It is just a group of discordant, meaningless dates. Period. Nothing going. But when you're a Christian and you realize that history is his story, it takes on an attraction. Why is that? Because it has a purpose. It's going somewhere. It's not like Henry Ford said, history is the sequence of one damn thing after another. Rather, history has a meaning and a purpose. And if history has a purpose, the whole has a purpose, guess what? Your life can have a purpose. But if the whole does not have a purpose, your life doesn't have a purpose. And isn't it strange? We wonder why. Well, gee, I wonder why there's so many teenage suicides. Why not? If you're taught there's no meaning, no purpose, you're just some sort of evolved protoplasm, your life does not have meaning. And there's a lot of young people out there that are starved for meaning and purpose in life, and so they decide, why not kill themselves? What's wrong with that? That's the logical conclusion. Just doing what you taught me, teach. You taught me it was meaninglessness, so I'm tired of being meaningless. I'm going to shoot myself. All right, so at the end of the exile, we have all these books. The Old Testament canon is vastly expanded. Now, what kind of books come into existence at the time of the exile? What new features or what features are now emphasized? God's sovereignty over whom? When Daniel talks to Nebuchadnezzar, the emphasis is on God's sovereignty over the kings, the Gentile nations. Why? Because if you are a Jew in the diaspora, you're having to live in Babylon, you're having to live over here, you're having to live over there, and you'd kind of like to know that Yahweh is not a local deity. You want to know that your God, the God of Israel, is not just the God of Israel, he's the God of creation. He is the God of history. He's the God that controls the Greeks. He's the God that controls the Romans. He's the God who controls the Caesars. He puts them up and he takes them down. As a believer, I would need that. You would need that. Do you see the role of special revelation? It provides the tools to live in that kind of an environment. If I were in the diaspora then, I would need a total answer. I'm ejected from my home. I'm going from place to place. I'm a foreigner everywhere I go. Now, how do I survive in that situation? I survive as a believer because I know my God goes with me because he is God of this nation as well as Israel it fell. So we have, again, what do we have? Emphasis. We have special revelation as a total answer. We have the book of Isaiah, in which he ridicules idolatry in Isaiah 40, 41, 42. Paul goes back to those passages. So we have this total answer. We have a framework of interlocking truth. God doesn't give them tidbits. God gives them a total picture of what is going on. That's the framework. Now, the third and final act. In Acts 17, turn to Acts 17, please. This is a major address in the scriptures. And there's commentators that say, oh, well, Paul made a mistake. Paul didn't make any mistake. Commentators made the mistake. Here we have Paul going into the heartland of unbelief. Isn't it striking? Moses goes to whom? To Pharaoh. Daniel winds up as high up in two of the major kingdoms. I have a friend of mine, the Muslim background believer, and he teaches Iranians. He's an Iranian. And, of course, Iranians are quick to tell you they are not Arabs. They are Persians, please. And they are very proud of their Persian heritage. And he was saying how the modern-day Iranian forgets his own Persian history. And so they're there with this nitwit that's going on about Israel and never, or the Holocaust never existed and so on. And Jeek points out to them, he says, you know, he says, Daniel was one of your foreign ministers, one of your high ministers at one time in Persia. Who? Daniel was. Guess what he was? He was a Jewish person. And by the way, you know what? There was a queen there, Jewish queen. And all of us, it's just an entree to the fact that at one time, Persia was friendly to the Jews. Who let them back in the land? It was Persia. So these nitwits now in Iran are out of step with their own Iranian history. Well, we come to Acts 17, and here Paul comes to the very city where Socrates had been four centuries prior. And he comes in and he begins to speak in verse 18. Certain Epicurean and Stoic philosophers encountered him and said, what does this Babylon want to say? And they interpret him. And I think I've mentioned this here before, so I won't belabor it. What, notice in verse 18, he seems to be a proclaimer of foreign gods because he preached to them Jesus and the resurrection. In other words, they hear Yesu and they hear Anastasis and they say the words go through them and they say, oh, there must be a God, Jesus, and a God resurrection. Now, this is classic. This is classic instance of misunderstanding. Now, Paul doesn't say, now, if you accept Jesus into your heart, you will be saved. This is not how Paul evangelizes these people. He knows he can't even get to first base if he doesn't clarify the two key words here, Jesus and resurrection. So, now, does he give him a definition of Jesus and a definition of resurrection right away? No, he doesn't. Look what he does. He starts out, verse 22, he's done a study of their religion, and he says, here's one of the weaknesses, because here in Greece, where the self-sufficiency of man was taught, he says, you've confessed that you don't have total knowledge. You're worshiping an unknown God. So epistemologically, he goes in at their weak point. He's caught them. Because they have worshipped an unknown deity, they have confessed that they do not have total knowledge. That's all he needs. There's the open door. Boom, boom. Now he's going to come through. Because your system cannot provide total knowledge. Now I'm coming to you. I don't have to prove God, because you guys already know him, because he knows Romans 1. And so what does he say in verse 24? What's the first statement he makes? He makes it God who made the heaven and everything in it, Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. And Robbie has a picture because he was there at Mars Hill, and he'll show you where you can sit on Mars Hill and you can see the Pantheon. And Paul's there, and he says, the God who made heaven and earth, he didn't make that. He doesn't dwell over there. Now you talk about politically incorrect. Now this is a serious public hearing. And Paul is gracious, but he is not mixing the system. What he doesn't want to do is what happened with Dagon. He's not trying to have them add Jesus and add the resurrection to this pantheon, because that's the amoeba sucking up and neutralizing the Word of God. That's not the Word of God. That's not the resurrection Paul believes in. So here he starts in. He has to clarify creation. And he goes on and he describes the whole framework here. He describes here in he's not worshipped with men's hands, so he needed anything. He gives to all men life, breath. If you look at your study Bibles, you'll see these are quotations. He's building them out of Old Testament texts. He might have possibly studied the Old Testament a little bit, don't you think? That's he gives to all men, as he made from one, all nations of men. You know what he's getting at there? Is the proud, arrogant Hellenist racism. The Hellenists and the barbarians. Paul says he made of one race, all nations of men. So immediately he subdues the entire universe by placing it under God as creator. Then he subsumes all of human history with a narration of human history from the biblical point of view. Must not have gone to a liberal Christian college. And he made from one blood every nation of men and has determined their pre-appointed times and boundaries of their dwellings. There is a philosophy of history embedded there in one sentence. The boundaries, the rise and the fall of nations is under the control of the hand of God. And then he goes on to tell us why. What's the teleology of history? What's the purpose of history? the rise and the fall of nations, he says in verse 27, so that they should seek the Lord in hope that they might grope after him and find him. What is the disturbances that go on in history? We think, for example, the Chinese, and they invaded Tibet. And I can remember as a young man listening to Lowell Thomas pleading as he interviewed the Dalai Lama, and they were pleading for help as the Chinese were threatening to come into Tibet. And the Chinese come into Tibet, and everybody thinks it's a catastrophe, it's a disaster. But the Tibetan red-hooded monks were the most demonic force on earth. The pure Tibetan pagan culture was under demonic powers. And the communists march in. And because Tibet is so far from Beijing, what do they bring with them? Radios. And what does the Far East Broadcasting Company do with the radio frequencies? Put the Word of God on it. So all of a sudden, Tibet is now reached with the Word of God as they never were before. Thank you, Mao Zedong. So you see how God plays the game. He superintends, and it's an outworking of this point. A Chinese Christian was telling me how, yes, the days of Mao Zedong were horrible, but one thing that he did do is he trimmed down the number of languages in China. So that he reduced the total number of languages, and it's made it easier for Gospels and the Word of God and Bibles to be translated. Now, you don't have to translate in 35 languages. Thank you, Mao Zedong, for another help. Now you condensed the languages. Isn't that what he did with Rome? You know, he wanted to get the Gospel out. So what did he do? He brought in the Roman army engineers. And they so nicely built roads that are still there, drive tanks on them still. There wrote all this, he built a transportation system for the gospel. Thank you. Thank you, Caesar. That was very nice of you to do that. So that's what Paul means when he says, the God, our Savior, is the Lord of history. As bleak as things look, and the furniture gets shook around, and catastrophes happen, look beyond them. Because this verse says, I'm doing it, that men might grope after me. For in him we live and move and have our being. And it's even of your poets, he quotes them saying, you guys have God consciousness because it pops up in your literature. Don't tell me you don't know God. You're talking about it all the time. And then we are the offspring. You ought not to think of that. And then he gets down in verse 30. Now see, he's given them the background, the framework. See, he's got to go through history. He's got to show them different things. He's got to give them the biblical view of this, the biblical view of that, and put it together as an organized system. Then he says, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent. Change your mind about me, he says. Because, threat note, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness. And now he brings in that Jesus that they didn't understand, the Jesus they were going to add to their little pantheon. He is going to be the judge of you. You Athenians, you're coming up for judgment. And you're going to be judged in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained, and he's given assurance by raising him from the dead. Now they understand those two words, Jesus and resurrection. But you see, they couldn't have understood it had Paul not gone through all this. So you watch Acts 17. It's a critical section. It's not the only place, but it's a great learning tool to how do we do this kind of thing? How do we make the gospel clear? So I want to conclude, and this is just some of the outline of the truths that Paul would have used. He comes down to these concluding principles, and I'm going to go through three of them. Page 26 in your notes. The point of contact. As we said from the other evening, the point of contact for our Bible teaching lies in the conscience of every man. We've got to stop acting like our hearers have never been in contact with God before we showed up. Romans 1 says they know God and they know everything about, not, you know, in general revelation. We should teach to our hearers as fellow creatures made in God's image, possessors of conscience, and if regenerate, of course, recipients of the indwelling Holy Spirit. Where their lives appear not to evidence such contact, we cannot let that dissuade us. That's where we get discouraged. And we want to call time out. This person's so far out. Yeah, they may be so far out, but they are in contact with God. And we may fire the Word of God at them and fire the Word of God at them and fire the Word of God at them. it will not return void. You say, well, these people don't become Christians. Then the Word of God condemns them. It hardens their hearts, or it brings them to Christ. But it does not remain null and void. It will produce an effect. Principle two, different hearers have different suppressions. We all know this intuitively. You know, some people have to be taken all the way to the pig pen with a prodigal son. And with those kind of people, you are almost there to grease their slide. Because like I said last night, sometimes you have to let people go down the drain. Have you ever, you know, worked with people with alcoholism, or you worked with people who are drug addicts? What does everybody tell you? You can't help them until what? Until they ask for help. And you can try all the tricks in the trade, and it doesn't do a particle of good. They've got to hit bottom before they come back up. And we can sometimes help that. We can take their own beliefs to their own logical conclusion. Help them grease the tread and help them see the implications of what they're saying. They don't even understand the implications of what they're saying. So help them. We should teach antithetically so that truth is contrasted as error. That doesn't mean go into every heresy or anything like that. It means you have to say what the Word of God says and what it's not saying. There has to be an antithetical thing here. What did Paul do in Acts 17? God does not do that. He does this. He doesn't dwell there. He dwells here. We ought not to worship him like that because we should worship him like this. That's antithesis. And that has to be part of the gospel, particularly today, to put a crisp, sharp edge on the Word of God. Now, the third one that I want to illustrate is the framework itself and how it is a coherent system of truth. One of the points that I think is going on here, I think I mentioned this last night, and if I didn't, if I do, my wife's at the point where she says, if you start to say something, I'm going to tell you, you told me that before. But I think one of the reasons why we in the Bible teaching circles are losing some of our finest people to reform theology. And I've thought about this because I've watched it happen. I've watched young fellows that really are sharp, that get into the Word, and they just gravitate to reform theology. And I wonder, what the heck is going on here? Here's what I think is going on, and here's how I think we can stop that. I think what happens is that your people who are your thinking people, that thinking is very important to them, what do they crave? They crave order. They crave to organize things. And Reformed theology appears to give an order. I mean, you can sit down with a 3x5 card and write out TULIP, and you've got the order. It doesn't require too much study. The problem is that in our circles, we fed them Bible stories and fragments. But we haven't fed them order in many cases. Now, I suggest to you that the Bible is a very orderly textbook, but not on the level of abstract theology. It can be organized as abstract theology, but the order that God has given to us in the canon is these stories are like pieces on a necklace. They're not just the beads. They're together in a string, a chronological progression that has a meaning and a purpose and an unfolding to it. There's a contract with terms, and guess what? God fulfills those terms. That's the order. So if we can teach people the framework and see, there's an order there. God is an orderly God, but it's not an abstract thing that somebody put on a 3x5 card. That's not the order. The order is implicit in the text. So yes, we've got to teach the fragments and we've got to teach the pieces, but there's got to be a time and a place where we emphasize the orderliness of our God, the program in history that he's going through. Now, we went through that last night. I want to close with two illustrations in the military. When the Air Force devises an assault, it puts together and spends a lot of time on what we call a strike package. And a strike package is a big plan, big, thick document. And in that document, there's all kinds of procedures. Each aircraft, each type of aircraft is assigned a mission. The large aircraft may be an air traffic controller, it may be ground surveillance, it may be tankers. They have to rendezvous at a certain point, and that to rendezvous at a certain point, you have to have so much gas aboard. If you have so much gas aboard, you've got to figure out how many planes you can refuel. You've got to figure out how much gas those planes have so they don't all try to refuel at the same time. There's a massive, massive set of management details that go into one of these strike packages. And each one of those planes is designed for a different purpose. Some are bombers, some are fighters, some are air superiority fighters. Some are stealthy aircraft that go in and deal with air defense installations. So they're the first guys in. Then there are other guys. There's the rescue fellows that come in if a plane is down and they have to rescue the guy and get him back out. So each plane has a function and a purpose in the large strike package. Now, this is no different than athletics, where you have football plays and you have your soccer positions or basketball. There's a place where there's orderliness, and you can't have one of these guys trying to lone wolf it. It's a little silly ad that the Pentagon tried to put out a while ago by the Army of One. You know, like everybody's going to be a Rambo in the Army. That's so stupid. There never has been an Army of One. The Army is a team. And Marines or Air Force or anything. It's a teamwork here. Now, here's what I suggest when you look at that strike package. Think to yourself, every one of those planes has a mission. It's got a design to do a job. Now, think of every story and every chunk, every major piece of revelation in Scripture. Think of the fact that when we go and we start teaching about creation, that's the background that protects our doctrine of language. We have all this slithering around now about hermeneutics. How stupid and waste of time this is. What we should have done 100 years ago when Wittgenstein and the other guys were doing the linguistic philosophy is, where were the Christians to develop a philosophy of language based on the Bible? I mean, we've got the Bible, it gives you a whole philosophy of language. It says the whole universe was spoken into existence. Is that a philosophy of language or not? What is the second person the Trinity call? It's a linguistic term. What did God say to Adam? I go name these things. What happened at Babel? What happened at Pentecost? I mean, you've got so much material in there, you could build an entire philosophy of life. Nobody did it. So now we're sitting here playing defensive warfare against all these guys that have got linguistic philosophy going. Where were the guys in our camp that could have developed an answer to this?
No. Where?
Nobody around. And so here we are now playing catch up. So the doctrines are there in Scripture to protect each other. If Jesus, people say, oh, well, I believe in Jesus. Well, do you believe in everything Jesus said? Yeah. Well, then do you believe that Jesus believed in a real Adam and Eve?
Well, no.
And so now we have to put this together. Now our Christology is impacting our creation narrative. But then I said, some of these pieces are general revelation interpreted under special revelation. So, evolutionists, show me your transition fossils. You had 200 years. Darwin said we couldn't find them. His theory was junk. Where are these things? Excuse me. So, the pieces here are pieces of truth, be they scriptural doctrine, whether they are narratives, whether there's something in archaeology, whether there's something, it's a whole field of truth. And these pieces are meant to fly together because God is an orderly God. They're not conflicting. They fit together. Another illustration from the Army, one of the field manuals, the bounding overwatch thing, where this is a movement where you have a unit go in and they come up to a situation, and they stop, halt, short, wherever my thing pointer is. They stop short of contact with the enemy right here, and they act as a cover for the bounding element that moves toward the enemy. And then in the theory of this particular tactic is the bounding element pushes the enemy back, becomes an overwatch element, while the overwatch element now becomes a bounding element. They're protecting each other. They're operating as a team. They're covering for one another. That's what the Word of God does if we present the Word of God as a coherent set of beliefs that cover everything. That's why in the book of Colossians, where Paul is dealing with this whole thing, remember how he talks about Jesus has created all things and he holds all things together? Talk about a high Christology. Man, he's talking about that little Jewish carpenter being the guy that's the CEO of the universe. Isn't this an amazing management thing, too? Think about how God picks the manager forever. He was a guy who walked around tired and experienced hunger. And he's going to be our judge. Not like Allah, some guy sitting up there with the 72 virgins. This is a God who walked around the face of the earth, and when we come, oh, Jesus, I was tired. So was I. Try blowing smoke in his face. Trial by peers. And so we have this magnificent depth to the Word of God. And we treat it like it's, you know, this is a gold mine we've got here for every area of life. Not just for a study in Colossians or something, but extend that study. Draw out the implications of Colossians. Where does it carry you? You can carry 1,000 miles of implications out of one chapter in the book of Colossians. Have the courage and the convictions that this is the Word of God, and it has a coherence, and it's faithful, and it covers every area. So for the third principle, conclusion, we should teach in a manner that integrates general and special revelation, events and doctrines, each part mutually reinforcing the other, so we surround the unbelief. Unbelief is coming to us as a total picture. And what we're going to do is we're going to project a total counter picture. We're going to challenge every square foot where unbelief has lodged itself. If they say the interpretation of this is that, we say the interpretation is not that, it's this. Well, I say the interpretation is, the Word of God says the interpretation is of this particular event, this particular natural area is thus and such. Now, it takes a lot of research and work, and we all can't do that. But that's where we, in the body of Christ, people have gifts in one area or another. And we're trying to encourage that. You've seen the creationist movement flourish in the last 40 or 50 years. We need other movements. We need movements in the arts. Thank God we have some people now that are formulating Christian law schools, Christian journalism. Boy, do we need people in the media. We need people that can go out there and establish their journalistic credentials and work their way up in the system. And it is possible. God hasn't shut the door, at least yet. I mean, the rapture hasn't happened. As pre-tribs, you know, we're not pessimists. We're not thinking the tribulation hasn't come yet. So, you know, pre-trib, we are pre. So since the rapture hasn't come, we have an open door to minister. And God may close the door in this country. He's going to open it in another country. He will not be stopped. The body of Christ will become complete. Then comes the rapture. All right, I'm going to terminate then. And Robbie, where do we stand now? Are we talking?
Why don't you give everybody a chance to stand up and stretch. And those who need to leave for whatever reason, give them an opportunity to go. We've got 2 or 3 minutes. We'll do Q&A.
And the Q&A, I guess, has to be short tonight.
No, 1:30.
Okay. Okay. Everybody.
So we'll have Q&A. It's 9:05. We'll go till 9:30 or Charlie's exhausted or whatever. So come on, Charlie.
Okay, I'll try to remember to... What did I remember to brief this, do the questions? Yeah. Okay. Yes, Tim.
You said several times that we're constantly, for the last several hundred years, constantly playing catch up. Is that maybe classifiable as a failure to understand why the divine mandate?
Okay, the question is, since we seem to be always playing catch-up for the last 200 years, is that because of a failure to take seriously the dominion mandate? And I think it does have something to do with that. And the strange thing is that the reformers encouraged certain areas. It's just that when the Reformation happened, it seems like they didn't, they let stuff just develop by itself. And that was a tradition that's been going on in a defense, I guess, of us fundamentalists. After the liberal the modernist fundamentalist debates in the 20s and 30s, we lost all our assets. So there weren't too many schools around to do that. So as harsh sometimes as I am with some schools, I'm just disappointed in what some of the Christian schools have done, when so many godly people put so much effort, so much fundraising into these schools, and gosh, what comes out at the end? And I think of Wheaton, for example, and I think that they were the heart, they were fundamentalist scholars at Wheaton at the 1910, 1920. And then, gosh, look what goes on here. Now we have a guy, one of the Wheaton historians, writing a book called Scandal of the Evangelical Mind. You know who the scandal of the evangelical mind is? We are. So there's a problem there. And it's just, I think the Lord's overcoming some of it. But like I said last night, it's coming just because individual Christians are undertaking this themselves to you know, do these things. But maybe it's because we haven't heard enough too. Maybe as our society gets more and more grossly and clearly pagan, it will motivate us to get out there and counter it somehow. I don't know. But Tim's question is right, is that I do think it's not taking seriously the high calling that God has given man. For example, every year in this country we have a holiday called Labor Day. When was the last time you ever heard a sermon from the pulpit on the biblical doctrine of labor? And yet, when you look at Genesis, the first image that we have of God is what? He's a laborer. And when he gets through working in the 6 days, just like a laborer, he looks back on his work. That's good. I like that. And here we have this powerful doctrine. And who were the people that had the doctrine and symbol of labor? The sickle and the hammer. Karl Marx. Why did we let that character dominate the thinking of labor? See? It's all tied into the scriptures. Any other questions? Yes.
When you mentioned the pagan framework that was a facade to distract the people in Egypt from their guilt before God, did you mean that the totalitarian implication of it was the failure of it?
The question is, when I said that the Egyptian culture is basically the pagan framework was a facade to relieve the guilt, what was the last end of your question?
You said that it never really worked in daily life. Did you mean, and as its totalitarian implications work themselves out, did you mean its failure to work is the totalitarian implications itself?
Yeah, that, I said the totalitarian implications, they worked out, they didn't, they failed in many areas. And my point there is that when you take the unbelieving mentality and try to apply it systematically, it will break down every time. Because it takes time sometimes to watch it break down. But break down it will, because it's false to reality. Reality is what the Word of God says it is. So where you have a false belief, for example, one of the interesting things is in Egyptian history, what was the only revolt that was successful? And it was done without an army. The Exodus. Now, isn't that striking when you go to Mesopotamian history and there are all kinds of upsets going on, and yet you have this stability in Egypt? And then by failure there is also the fact, if you read Egyptian literature, it's a literature of despair. In spite of the fact that you have this totalitarianism and this order, this craving for order, on the other hand, you have this literature, this is, people are sad, they're depressed, there's no hope. So it doesn't fulfill that, and it can't, because when you go to totalitarianism and you go to a rationalism, you get very abstract, and you're just abstract. You're divorced from reality. So my biggest point there is that unbelief ultimately fails. And what happens is, and this is a good thing to remember, is that we Christians are often called hypocrites, and sometimes rightly so, because we don't live consistently to what we say we believe. But that's a two-edged sword, because no unbeliever can live consistently with their unbelief, because they'll have to, in the course of a day, in the course of only one day, they will abandon their unbelief every time they make a moral judgment. Because when they make a moral judgment, say, that's bad, they're not just saying, it's bad to me. And you can test that. When you hear somebody say, just for jokes and laughs, just sometime when you have a good relationship with someone like that and you hear them, that's bad. Or whenever something goes wrong, who gets damned? It's God is the one who is supposed to be damning it. And when everything's going right, it's Mother Nature. When everything is bad, it's an act of God. Now, why is that so? Because they intuitively know God's behind it, but they don't want to glorify Him. They call Mother Nature's another cop-out. Instead of saying, this is neat, this is how God designed it. I mean, I like to, at work sometimes, we come across these neat things going on. We talk about the weather and the atmosphere. We see something happen, and it's neat. And so I'll just deliberately say, now, didn't God do a great job designing that one? Because I just want to see what happens when I say that. And I'm the boss, and they can't do anything about it. So, but it's in a way of just provoking the conscience. And you just watch it. I mean, you don't even have to say anything. Just, when you're working side by side with a non-Christian, maybe you've tried to witness to them before, or they're just with you and they're your friends. This is amicable. And you watch them. And it's interesting. You just take notes to yourself just to learn, just observe. And see how many times this person is acting as though the universe really does have a purpose to it, that there really is a right and a wrong, and that you can think correctly about what's going on. And you'll be surprised. And that's how you learn. You just observe and just watch it. And it's kind of neat to watch. And then you just keep it up here for a tidbit someday in a conversation. Right. Yes?
How do we, as believers in Christ with Bible doctrine, how do we counteract this liberal movement of the liberal churches that used to be fundamental? How can we do this in our everyday life? Just a kind of a synopsis that would help us in our faith rest life to show Christ and show God's plan that you're talking about.
How would we show God's plan to people out of the liberal church?
Well, yes, that they've gotten 25 programs, and they got this and they got that, and they've gotten away from the gospel and the basic studying the Bible and using it in the faith rest life. How do we do this in our approach today with them as we talk to them in our daily lives?
How would we, in our talking to them in our daily walks and contacts, reach out to the people who are coming out of these basically religious areas?
Yeah, give them the truth that you're talking about.
Well, the essence of the gospel is that it's an answer to a question. And we want to be sure they're asking the right question before we give them the answer to it. And 90% of our effort isn't in giving the answer. 90% of our effort is trying to get them to ask the right question. And the question is, how can I be saved? It's the Philippian jailer. And how do we get the person to think that way? Well, one of the problems we face in our culture today is the price we're paying as a social entity for moral relativism. Because, what's right for you isn't right for me and that sort of stuff. And as long as someone's trapped in that kind of a mode of thinking, they cannot take seriously guilt, legal guilt, before a holy, righteous God. They cannot that doesn't register with them. That's all suppressed. It's all gooed up in this deception. So it turns out that perhaps discussing a true right and a wrong. For example, if you hear them say, well, you know, I think that's wrong, something about the environment or something like that. And an innocent way to do this in a non-threatening way is to just say, well, that's interesting. Can you explain why you believe that way? Ask them questions. And one of the things that Mike brought out, you remember when he was doing Job the first day we were here? Did you notice how many times in Job God asked questions? What was the first thing, a sentence or a question that he went in the Garden of Eden with after the fall? It's a question. And when he comes to Job, he asks him a question. And Jesus often would turn to his disciples and he'd do what? Ask him a question. And you know, I think a question is very interesting provoker, because if I ask you a question, that forces the initiative on you. If you can think of it that way, a question is an offense, not a defense. When you're giving an answer, you're on the defense. So instead of us being always the object, I mean, people come to us, well, I don't think that, and what do you think of this? And reverse it. There's an old Jewish saying, answer a question with a question. Now, why are you saying that to me? and turn it around, because the problem, folks, is that we got to get people thinking honestly, because there's just a lot of self-deception out there. And that's the way God works. He works with questions. And when you ask a question, there's got to be something start up here. Because they've got to verbalize an answer, and nobody wants to act like a total fool. And so they before they open their mouth, they've got to think through, well, what am I saying here? So it's a healthy technique to use. Just think of some judicial questions. Yes.
We're trying to get to a point when we're giving someone the gospel. And it seems like, I understand we need to bring in these other concepts to surround them. But it seems like on another level or point that when we're talking about creation and we're talking about these other things, it's kind of letting them off the hook. I mean, mm-hmm. They don't want to talk about creation as long as you're not getting too close. How far do you go with that?
Okay, good question. And that is, in an everyday conversation, how far into this other area do you go? Because then you think, well, I'm diverting the issue from the gospel now. So what do I do? That is, I think, it's very person specific, because some people really do need to have an assurance that the Bible has these answers. This is one reason why when John Cross did his work on the stranger, he did it chronologically in a non-threatening manner. And what they teach you to do when they do that approach. Now, again, that's only one approach, but I like that approach, because what it does, you go through these, start off at creation, and not in the depth, but you just go to the basic idea. People say, well, wait a minute, I got a question about that. Well, just a minute. Let's just go a little further. And what you're doing is you're basically taking them on a tour, a quick tour of the panorama here. And you're kind of, to prevent going off in the tangents, you're trying to say, well, there are answers to that, but let's keep going. And what you're trying to do is keep the conversation on the nature of who God is. That's basic stuff. It gets back to those gospel essentials. But in doing that, you will encounter people who just suck up the idea of God, and then you say, well, I have to come around and explain this again. And so, and particularly if you want to get an exercise in grease and frustration, is try to talk to an Indian Hindu. Man alive, it's tough to get the conversation started because they're so far off. Now, here in our country, most people have a little bit of knowledge, so it's a little easier to do that. But what you try to get across who and what God is, because if that isn't clear in their mind, you can never clarify the issue of sin and guilt. And if the guilt and sin is not clarified, they're never going to trust in Christ. They won't see that. Yeah.
If you're talking to someone and you start talking about God being the creator of all things, all of a sudden, you know where they're going. Mm-hmm. They want to talk about evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And what is some tool that you can use? Maybe this is something they have to get by before they can accept the gospel, or maybe they're just wanting to use this just to argue with.
Yes.
And I don't want it to wind up being an argument. You go, wait, what happened? I was trying to get the gospel, wind up in an argument about evolution.
Right. Okay. The question is, what happens there when you start off with God and he's creator like Paul does in Acts, and all of a sudden now they want to bring up the evolution issue? And the reason this is happening is because what I said is that unbelief has erected a whole network of beliefs here. And when you start probing the gospel, you're triggering this whole network. And that's where, if a person is not sincere, yeah, they'll use this kind of stuff to chase it down. And that's where you have to kind of exercise judgment as to whether you really want to go chasing that thing, because now you're responding to their initiative. And again, I would suggest that you use some sort of a reproach where you say, well, there are answers to that, but hear me out. Let me go through this and get your structure down there first. And knowing this other is there. But the reason we're having this kind of a problem is because that's part of the whole culture picture that we're attacking. And they are going to bring this up. I mean, it's a very diabolical thing that's happened here. And this is why Henry Morris and the others in the creationist movement years ago decided something has to be done about this. We've got to get direct challenges to this. Sometimes what happens is you can go the other way. If they want to go chase the root, start asking them questions. Well, gee, you know, you believe in evolution. How do you see evolution is happening? And you keep asking them. And you know, you think through, read some creationist materials, so you know kind of the right questions to ask, and just see what happens. And you'll quickly find out if they're just hot air people or whether they really have questions. But that's what you're doing in that maneuver is you're trying to get them to articulate clearly the unbelief in the hopes that they will really see where this is leading. And it's that question, do you bring them to the gospel right away, or are they so messed up you've got to move them away from the gospel all the way down to the pig pen here before they realize, gee, you know, this isn't really cool over here. So it's person specific. And it's a conversation here and there, you know. Most of the time you're stuck where you don't have a lot of time with people, or you're in a business relationship and you have to kind of be careful how you work with that relationship. But the thing about the framework is that we have to have the confidence that when we run across this sort of stuff, it is basically hot air, and it's wonderful to have your feet so solidly in the Word of God that you're not thrown off balance yourself by this. And sometimes, you know, it's as innocent as after a discussion like that, and you're in the cafeteria or something, and you say grace before the food right in front of them. But you see, that one act, that very act of thanking God for food, we're not even talking about creation evolution, but we're showing it. Okay. And then when suffering comes up, somebody's sick, one of their loved ones is sick, the offer to prayer. I've been told by those who have worked with Muslims, that's one of the entrees to Muslims, is to offer to pray for when they have sickness and health. Because they don't think in terms of that intimacy with Allah. Allah is a distant thing for them. And to be able to come into the presence of God in the name of Jesus Christ and pray, that says 200 pages worth of theology.